I'm there. Right. morning. On behalf of Karen's family, thank you for coming and supporting them. It's been a few months of difficulty, obviously, a lot of loss and grief, but your being here today is going to encourage them. It's going to help them with this. And so we're grateful for your attendance with us today. I want us to begin our service by looking at some verses from, you know what, Janine?
What?
I forgot to turn that back projector on.
Okay.
Can you turn that on, or people will think I can read this? I can't. I didn't memorize all of this. We had a person one time who was like, wow, he really knows that. I apologize for this. I tell you what, let's do it. It's going to take a second to come on. I'll read off the screen here, and we'll follow along that way. I just want to say, though, right, we're talking about God has a plan. God has a plan for us in this life. Thankfully, he has a plan for us in a life to come. He has a plan for Karen. Karen's experiencing the plan right now, okay? And so as we look at these verses, they are significant, and never more so than in the context we're in. And let's remember the context that we look at these in. All right. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the old heaven and the old earth had disappeared, and the sea was also gone. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven like a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. I heard a loud shout from the throne saying, look, God's home is now among his people. He will live with them and they will be his people. God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. And there will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain. All these things are gone forever. And the one sitting on the throne said, look, I am making everything new. And then he said to me, write this down, for what I tell you is trustworthy and true. And he said, it is finished. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To all who are thirsty, I will give freely from the springs of the water of life. All who are victorious will inherit all these blessings, and I will be their God, and they will be my children. But cowards, unbelievers, the corrupt, murderers, the immoral, those who practice witchcraft, idol worshippers, and all liars, their fate is in the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death. Then one of the seven angels came and said to me, come with me. I will show you the Lamb. I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb. So he took me in the spirit to a great high mountain, and he showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God. The 12 gates were made of pearls, each gate from a single pearl. And the main gate was pure gold. Main street was pure gold, as clear as glass. I saw no temple in the city, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. And the city has no need of the sun or moon, for the glory of God illuminates the city, and the Lamb is its light. The nations will walk in its light, and the kings of the world will enter the city and in all their glory. Its gates will never be closed at the end of the day, because there is no night there. And all the nations will bring their glory and honor into the city. Nothing evil will be allowed to enter, or anyone who practices shameful idolatry and dishonesty, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's book. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you that you do have a plan, and you have taken this plan and brought it to us and revealed it to us, Lord. We're so grateful for that, for your plan and the place that you have for those who know you as their Savior. And we pray, Father, this morning that this service will bring honor and glory to you, and that through it as well, you would encourage and comfort us. In Jesus' name we pray. Karen has a couple of songs that she requested that we sing today. So I want us to have a nice, mighty voice today, okay? Carla's going to lead us. I'm not going to lead us. She's going to lead us on the panel, but the words are on the screen. So if you can, again, we'll just stand and we'll sing this first song, How Great Thou Art. I think it's one that we're familiar with and one that Karen requested that we would sing today. Episcopal Church. Karen's parents owned a tavern and liquor store in Madison. There, Karen's father fixed the basement so that children could play and also placed a small cot for her in case Karen wanted to go to sleep before closing time, which was often late. On Saturday evening, farm families would come to Madison to buy groceries and then go to the tavern for the evening until midnight when the tavern closed. Their children would bring puppies, kittens, and other assorted animals, making these weekly playtimes in the tavern basement very memorable for the rest of Karen's life. Karen and her parents moved to Ogallala in 1952 when she was in seventh grade and opened a coast-to-coast hardware store. During her school years, Karen was involved in choir, band, and musicals. It was in the latter where she met her future husband, Mike Welsh, while practicing and performing Babes in Toyland during their senior year. They were together for 67 years thereafter. While in high school, Karen also worked at McDonald's clothing store in Ogallala, while also serving as an usher at Prairie Theater in the evenings. In the summers, she worked as a lifeguard at the Ogallala swimming pool. Karen graduated from Ogallala High School in 1956, ranked in the top five scholastically in her class of 72 students. She went on to further her education at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln, where she was a member of Chi Omega sorority. She and Mike were known for loving to dance and were often the first ones on the dance floor, bringing others to join them. On February 1, 1959, Karen married Mike in the Ogallala Methodist Church. The couple lived in a family-owned farm in Perkins County for 7 years before moving back to Ogallala. Karen worked one day a week at Corner Junction Gift Shop for several years, and she was an active member and officer of PEO Chapter CL. Karen was active, loving presence in the lives of her children's lives, serving as room mother at school for several years, as a constant volunteer in their activities, even as the den mother for Tim's Cub Scout pack. Her love of being involved in their lives continued as her children got older, with Karen even traveling to France, Spain, and England to be with her daughter Christy in her high school Spanish class. Karen and Mike traveled extensively as well, from New Orleans to Greece to the backwoods of Canada. In 1996, they visited Dublin, Ireland, with a group of other band parents to watch their daughter Christy march in the Cornhusker Marching Band in the Dublin St. Patrick's Day Parade. Karen and Mike returned to Ireland, Scotland, and England twice more with their son Jeff and his wife Cheryl. They also made more trips to Europe with Jeff and Cheryl to Italy, Switzerland, Austria, and Germany. After retirement, the couple purchased a home in Naples, Florida, and spent most of their winter there for nearly 20 years. Tim and his family lived in the area, so Karen was able to enjoy her Florida grandchildren in the winter and her Nebraska grandchildren in the summer. They met many dear friends while in Naples and enjoyed pool time, beach time, cocktail, and snack hour. Karen's priority in life was always her children and her grandchildren. When once told that she raised three great kids, Karen responded, "Thank you. I hope so. I think that's what I was born to do." Her children and grandchildren heartily agree with that statement and will miss her very, very. She was always a cheerful and loving light in their lives. Karen was preceded in death by her parents, Ray and Mary Adkins, her two brothers, Meredith Adkins and Dr. Nathan Adkins, and her husband, Mike, and son, Jeff, losing both in April of this year. She is survived by her son, Timothy Welsh, daughter, Christine, and her husband, Mike Liebhart, daughter-in-law, Cheryl Welsh, six grandchildren, Sarah, Claire, and Jack Welsh, Zane, Chase, and Cooper Liebhart. Well, some of those grandchildren have some memories that they wish to pass along to us as well, so we're going to invite them to do that at this time.
This is from my mom's point of view, just so I know. Dear Mom, how can I thank you with mere words? You have been the most beautiful, patient, funny, kind, and attentive mother anyone could ask for. And you have been the single most influential person in my life. Thank you for my childhood. I know I had the capacity to drive you crazy at times. We all knew that when your eyes would begin to shift back and forth very quickly, we had pushed you a little bit too far. But put up with so much. I got silly putty stuck in the carpet. I hid when I got up too early one morning to watch cartoons, and you thought I had been kidnapped. I was mouthy, messy, and muttonous. But you took it all in stride. Baking for holidays and classroom parties, ironing everything we wore and the bed sheets, reading to us tirelessly, singing, whistling, and smiling every day. Thank you for staying up with me on so many long nights when my asthma would be very bad, rocking me, patting my back, and then running me to the ER for a breathing treatment when it got too bad. Thank you for taking me to the Ramada Inn swimming pool so many afternoons, allowing us to have our own private paradise for a few hours, swimming, sunbathing, and laughing. Thank you for letting me play my drums for almost an hour of the day or night, any hour of the day or night. You never complained and never asked me to stop, although grumbling had to be at the very least annoying. Thank you for mowing the lawn for so many years, often in your bathing suit. You always had the best suntan around. Thank you for coming to every home football game for the entire time I was in both high school band and Cornhusker band. Hot games, cold games, rainy and snowy games. I could go on thanking you for days, Mom. You listened to me when I had good days and when I had tough days. You held me as I cried, and you jumped for joy when I tried. You were the best grandma in the world, taking care of our babies, and as they grew, attending more band concerts, football games, baseball games, soccer games, and swim meets. You were often cold or wet, but as the photos proved, you still wore your radiant, infectious smile through it all. Every single time we left the house to go home, you would come outside and wave to us and blow kisses. To the best hugger, the one with the softest kiss and the most understanding eyes, I love you with all my heart and always will. You are my best friend. You will always be my beautiful mommy. Love, your daughter, Kristen.
So many things to love about her. She was very tender-hearted and wore her heart on her sleeve. She was kind and gentle. When she loved you, you knew it. She loved her children fiercely and then her grandchildren just as much. She always referred to us as her Florida grandchildren, and she loved to spend time with us at the pool or beach, always coming prepared with candy or fruits.
Her hugs were the best. She was never the first one to let go. And we'd love to comment on how much we had grown each year until we all were eventually much taller than her. She was such a good cook. Her brown sugar coffee cake, her rhubarb pie, egg casserole, and chocolate cake on birthdays were the best. She loved music and to dance. She loved caring for her dogs and would always be smiling and laughing as her cheeks got all rosy. She loved reminiscing about growing up with her brothers and especially loved to talk about her parents' tavern in Madison and how much fun she had hanging out there.
Recently, our own mom had a conversation about what a wonderful mom and grandma she was, and she replied, "I sure hope so. I think that's what I was born to do." And she absolutely was. We love our grandma very much and are so very lucky to have had her. Thank you all for coming and for loving her too.
Still on the road, since when the war.
requested we had this morning. Let me just, before I take us into God's Word for a few minutes, let me just also share that, man, we appreciated Karen in our church family and in our own personal family as well, and privileged to be her pastor and to just to know her and Mike both. But she was kind and generous and smiled, and you said thank you for loving her. I, you know, some people, maybe you don't know this or realize this, but some people are easier to love than others. Did you know that? Did you know that? And that's true for everybody. You know, pastors are supposed to love, and we do, we love everybody, but just sometimes it's easier to love others. Karen was certainly on the easy to love side of the scale, and so we're, you know, we're gonna definitely miss her. Her sweet smile, and well, she was just always, she came, you know, she was just, everything was in its place. She was perfectly put together. Can I say that? Is that not the right? Yeah, you know what I mean, don't you? She was so very, very sweet. And our son Samuel played the drums in church, and Karen had an ear for the drums, and so she would often comment to him and appreciate his playing, and I know that was just kind and encouraging to him as well, so. Some good memories that we have, right? Those memories are helpful to us. Clearly, we want to share them, we want to remember them and embrace them. And realize some people don't have that opportunity. They don't have a mom or a grandmother like that. Maybe they didn't know them, maybe they weren't that kind of person or individual. So, blessing to have that in your life. And that obviously then makes it hurt, doesn't it? Makes it hurt, but we would rather have loved, right, and had that relationship and now feel that pain than not. Well, let's see this morning. I want to take us this morning to maybe the most well-known passage in all of Scripture, Psalm 23. I think there's something about coming to a very familiar passage and remembering it. And I hope that in the, you know, the days and weeks and months ahead, as you hear Psalm 23, some of this will be remembered alongside it as well. You'll remember. So I think there's something, you know, good about coming to a very familiar passage in a time like this as well. So Psalm 23, of course, very well known, and opens with this verse: "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." And that opening verse tells us two things. It tells us, first of all, that we have needs in this life, don't we? And that's obvious, we know that. We have needs in this life. But it also tells us that there is someone who is able to provide for those needs. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Why? Because the Lord is shepherding me and he's providing for those things that I need. So we could look at it from the other's perspective and say, you know what? If I don't have the Lord as my shepherd, then what's going to happen? There are going to be things that I need in my life, but they're not being provided for me, because if he's not my shepherd, where will they come from? He is not the one there doing that for me. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Verse 2 says, he makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. Verse 2, he provides for our physical needs. He provides for our physical needs. In this case, he just mentions the basic, the food and the water. Green pastures and quiet waters. The Lord provides us with everything that we have comes from him. Everything that we have is from the Lord's hand. The breath that we're taking in right now without even realizing, right, without even paying attention, that comes from the Lord. The opportunity. So, well, but I work. I can do things. Well, yeah, you definitely have a part to play. But the Lord's the one who gives you the energy, the strength, the wisdom, the intelligence to work and to do things and to accomplish things. He's the one who provides those attributes to you. He is the giver. He is the giver. So he provides physically. Verse 3, he tells us he also provides for us, though, not just physically, but also spiritually. Verse 3 tells us he restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. He restores my soul. We certainly have spiritual needs. The word restores there is a Hebrew word that means exactly what you think, to turn back, to return something. So if we restore a vehicle, if we restore some furniture, whatever we're doing, we're returning it back into a good condition. He restores my soul, the author says. David writes and says that. Something that needs to be turned back. My soul needs that the Lord provides for me spiritually. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. He guides me on the right path. The shepherd knows the right path for us to take. And he is the one who guides us in that path. And again, spiritually, he's leading us where it is best for us. He's given us his word to direct us in our lives. He says, this is how I've planned life. This is how I've designed life. Live life in this way. Follow my path. It's the best for you. He provides for us physically. He provides for us spiritually. The Lord is my shepherd. Verse 4 talks about his protection over us. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. He's providing protection for us. Even in the darkest times, when I walk through the darkest valley, that dark valley, and we all know there are many dark valleys in life. And this family has experienced, they've been walking through a lot of dark valleys in this year. And there are many. I think that's just the honesty of God's word. God's word doesn't say, put on a happy face. There are hard times. It acknowledges that. It recognizes that. And so we can appreciate and trust in that. But notice something. Something that this verse tells us. Three things here. Notice that God does not prevent the dark valleys in our life. He doesn't prevent them from coming. That's not the world we live in. We live in a fallen world. There are going to be dark valleys in our life. But notice as well, something else. Nor does he leave us when the dark valleys come. I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. I fear no evil. Why? For you are with me. You are with me. He doesn't prevent them, but he doesn't leave us when those dark valleys come. He doesn't say, oh boy, it looks really dark ahead. I have to tell you what, you go on through this valley. I hope if you can make it through, and I hope you do. I really hope you do. I'll meet you on the other side. It's not who our God is. He says, I'm not going to prevent these things from happening, but I'm going to walk with you through them. His rod and his staff. For the shepherd, the rod and the staff was there for the good of the sheep. And Jesus says, I will shepherd you through even the most difficult days of your life. Follow me. Follow me. And then the third thing he does is he says he stays with you and continues to protect us through that. He provides this protection for us in verse 4. He's not a God who abandons. He's a God who stays with us. Verse 5, we go from protection in verse 4 to provision in verse 5. In verse 5, he says, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Still, that's a dark place, right? The enemies are right there. But what is God doing? He's providing for us. He's making provision for us. You've anointed my head with oil. My cup overflows. Even in the difficulties of this world, God provides for us what we need. His provision is there for us, even in the midst of our enemies. And I don't know that, I think this is more spiritually talking about than physically, you know, counting off our enemies and sitting down at a table. No, there's a lot of things in life that are difficult, that are enemies to us. God says, I'm going to provide for you in the midst of that. I'm going to provide for you. I love the last three words, my cup overflows. My cup overflows. You know, it is not looking at a cup and holding a cup, it's not an image of just a little meager amount or just again, what do I have in it? Just a little bit? No. It's holding a cup that what? Is overflowing. It's overflowing with what? With God's provision. With God's presence, with God's help, with what we need at these times in our life. It's not God measuring out just a little bit of grace with an eyedropper, right? You want to get just a little bit, what do you use an eye and just come? No, it's God with a fire hose providing for us, provision, protection and provision. This little psalm closes in verse 6, talking about two places and two times. Surely goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life. That's here and now, all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. That's another place at another time. Here and now, he says, goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life. The here and the now. Sometimes it doesn't feel like God loves us, does it? Sometimes we don't feel that. We don't have that. Now let your feelings and the circumstances of your life take away the truth of God's word. Because God says, I love you all the time. Even when you don't feel it, you don't sense it. And sometimes our kids say to us, you don't love me, right? We do. But it's the circumstances they're dealing with that make them say that, think that. And sometimes circumstances in the here and now, but the psalmist says, surely goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life. Here and now, God provides for us. But then there's this hope as well, that this is not just all there is. There's more than just this. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. That's another time and a different place. And God's provided for us that when this world ends, and we're reminded that it ends today, there's a world coming. And he says, I'm going to be there. I'm going to dwell in the house of the Lord forever. There is another world that God is preparing for us. And we will be there with him forever. We read in Revelation 21. We read in that book that the Lord God will come and be, right? He will be among his people. I will be there with them. That's a place of encouragement for us. We look forward to that. Karen has that at this moment. Now, this psalm, of course, rests on one very important condition. It's right there in verse 1 when we started. The Lord is my shepherd. And then all of these things flow out from that. So the condition, of course, then is the Lord my shepherd? How do I know that the Lord is my shepherd? How do I come into that relationship where the Lord is my shepherd? Well, of course, this imagery of shepherd and sheep is not just something we find in the Old Testament. Jesus said in John chapter 10, verse 11, Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. Jesus says, I'm the good shepherd. I take on the role of the shepherd. I'm the good shepherd, he's telling us. And the good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Jesus died for us. He laid down his life for us. I am the good shepherd. This incredible image from the Old Testament, Jesus stands and says, that's me. I'm God. I do these things for you. And the only way then to have the Lord as your shepherd is through Jesus. Through Jesus. Jesus died for us. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world, that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life, everlasting life. That is a broad invitation, isn't it? Who's that invitation to? It says, whoever. Whoever believes. It says, God so loved the world. I'm not talking about the world physically. We're talking about the atmosphere. He's talking about us. The people who inhabit this world. He loves us. And so a very, very broad invitation. Whoever believes in him will not perish. So we can have this relationship with God through his Son, Jesus Christ, who is the good shepherd. And Jesus also said in John 14:6, how do we come into this relationship? He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So John 3:16, very broad invitation. Whoever will believe, the whole world, it's there. But in John 14:6, there is a exclusive way that this takes place. It's through the person and work of Jesus Christ in him alone. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Let me illustrate that for you. So if I said to you, hey, any of you are welcome to call me. And the church number is 284-4441. Any of you, you're free to call me. So that is an open invitation, isn't it? I'm not limiting it to anyone. Any of you can call. But if you're going to call, what do you have to do? You have to use that number. What if you go 284-4442? You're just off by one. I mean, come on. Won't it ring through here? Well, will it? I've made the invitation as broadly as I can, but you still have to do something very specifically, don't you? And that's what Jesus is saying to us. The invitation is there for all of us to believe, but it has to be through Jesus Christ. And that's how we come into this relationship. And that's how we can know, Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. How? Because I believe in what Jesus Christ did for me on the cross. That's what makes me acceptable to God. Not the many, many good things. And Karen had many, many good qualities. Let me tell you something. None of those good qualities is what God saw in her so that he would accept her and make her acceptable to him. No. All of us fall short. All of us sin. So how are we going to get there? Only through what Jesus has done for us. Karen is acceptable to God because of her belief in Jesus Christ as her Savior. And that alone makes her acceptable to God. And only through that is she in his presence today. Truth that Jesus asked us to believe is that he died on the cross. He died for you and for me to pay the penalty for the sins that we owe. The only way to pay that penalty is by accepting what he has done. I'm confident today that Karen wants you to believe in the message of Jesus Christ as well. To be confident that when we gather at a place in a time like this for you, that we will also be able to say, because of your belief in Jesus Christ and what he did on the cross for you, that you're acceptable to him. Nothing more you must do but believe, put your trust in him. And what he did on the cross was for you. Then the Lord will be your shepherd. And all of these things will be true for you as well. Karen had another song she suggested that we sing, so I suggest that we sing. It's on your screen behind me. John Newton, of course, famously wrote Amazing Grace. Now, John Newton was no Karen Welsh, was he? He was a slave trader. He described himself as vile, and But something happened in his life. God's grace came into his life. And he put his faith in Jesus Christ. And then he wrote this song. This song, very familiar. John Newton said this. He said, my memory is nearly gone, but I remember two things. I am a great sinner. And Jesus is a great Savior. And that's what gives us this grace that comes into our lives. And this hope for a world to come. Okay? Well, let's do this. Let's sing this together. You want to stand or you want to just stay seated? I see a nod to stand. We'll go with the family wish. If you can. If you can't, just stay seated. That's fine. Again, Carla will lead us. Thank you. just begun. Good things for us. Well, I'm going to close us in prayer, and then we're going to do something that we were going to do at the cemetery, but we're going to do it here, since it's not the most enjoyable day. So after I'm done praying, we will proceed with that. But so just stay seated after the prayer. Father, we thank you this day, Lord, for all that you are, all that you have given to us. Lord, it is difficult to live this life. We are so thankful that you are the shepherd who leads us through every day. And we're thankful for that. Father, I pray for all of us that we would have you as our shepherd. That we would know you as our Savior. That we would have put our trust in Jesus Christ. So that one day as well, we can join you and join Karen as well. We're thankful for that, Lord. It'll be a great day, a tremendous day. Give us grace, Lord, for each day going forward without Karen present in our lives. And we pray for your comfort and your peace to guard each of us. And I pray that especially for her family, these children and grandchildren, Lord, for others who are close to her. Lord, help us to be drawn back to the truth of your word and be strengthened by that in these days ahead. Thank you, Lord, for your promises. We thank you that you are faithful to keep them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We are doing that song right now, aren't we?
Yeah, after the song. Tell you what. Thank you.
member of our sisterhood has passed through the sunset gates to chapter eternal. Today, we pay loving tribute to the memory of Karen Welsh. We grieve because we shall have no more the visible presence of her whom we loved. But we are grateful for our association with her and for an abiding faith in the promises of our Lord.
Don't let your heart be troubled. Trust in God and trust in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house. I would not tell you this if it were not true. I am going there to prepare a place for you. After I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you too with me so you may believe who I am.
I love you, people, with a love that will last forever. That is why I have continued showing you kindness. God loved you. He loved the world so much that he gave his one and only Son, so that whoever believes in him may not be lost, but have eternal life.
The commandment of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. Your kingdom is built on what is right and fair. The Lord loves us very much, and his truth is everlasting. Blessed are the dead who die from now on in the Lord. The Lord, the Spirit says, yes, they will rest from their hard work, and the reward of all they have done stays with them.
Jesus answered, I am the way, the truth, and the life. The only way to the Father is through me.
Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me will have life, even if they die. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die.
There are heavenly bodies, and there are earthly bodies. But the beauty of the heavenly bodies is one kind, and the beauty of the earthly bodies is another. The sun has one kind of beauty, the moon has another beauty, and the stars have another. And each star is different in its beauty. It is the same with the dead who are raised to life. The body that is planted will ruin and decay, but it is raised to a life that cannot be destroyed.
Let us pray. God, our eternal creator, you have blessed us with the wonders of life and the sweetness of loved ones. Renew your assurance to each of us that you have prepared an immortal home for all who love you. Gracious Lord, we know that you sustain us with your Holy Spirit to give us courage. Bestow your holy comfort upon each loved one. To God's gracious mercy and protection, we commit our sister in the name of our Redeemer. Amen.
The fragile beauty of flowers will perish, but the principles of faith, love, purity, justice, and truth abide forever. The single star sparkles anew, set in heaven.